Hey traders, we'll be getting started in just a moment. Please take a minute to read this disclaimer. All right. Good morning, traders, and welcome to this weekly strategy webinar. Today is Monday, October 23rd, and I'm Michael Boutros, Senior Technical Strategist with Forex.com. It's a pleasure to be with you guys this morning. Febby, David, good morning. Another David with a question on Euro. I'll hit that for sure. Great to be with you guys. The last full week of October, we do have some event risk on tap, specifically ECB, BOC rate decisions. We have key inflation data out of the US into the close of the week, employment data out of the UK tomorrow. So there's plenty of event risk on tap, but more importantly are the technical setups. And as we go through the setups this week, guys, FX markets, it's just sort of a mess on some of them. Not so much that the levels aren't clear, just a complete lack of momentum. And hopefully we'll look for that to break this week. So on the menu, we'll start off as always with a look at the DXY, Euro dollar, Sterling dollar, dollar CAD, dollar yen, which has done absolutely nothing, Aussie dollar. And then we'll jump into gold, oil, SPX, NASDAQ, and the Dow. Any other questions or trade setups? As always, guys, feel free to throw them on the message board at any time. And I got you on dollar yen and Euro dollar. Roland dollar Swiss, yeah, classic Roland question. I got you. And February, great to see you this morning as well. All right, let's jump right in. So here's what's going on with the DXY. This obviously, guys, this is the report from October 4th. So we've been tracking this one for some time. Just want to show you the side-by-side comparison. We're still holding this critical range above 105.40. 107.18 resistance. Okay. As we were stretching right into the start of the month, that was the resistance level that we were talking about. That was our concern on the back of this 11-week stretch to the upside in the DXY. That's still the high, guys. 3 weeks later, going our fourth week later, that's still key resistance. Again, noting the severity of this trend, guys, this is the original 2011 slope, all parallels of that same slope. And certainly we've gotten major inflection off that back in March. It's exactly where we topped out back in October. So we're coming off of uptrend resistance. That's been essentially the game plan since we started the month. We're going right to the end of the month. Haven't gotten a really substantiated pullback yet. I mean, look, the following week after that report was published, we did get that pullback that settled right into support, right, before rebounding. And we're sort of right here right now. But at the end of the day, we're trying to assess, is that the extent of the pullback off uptrend resistance? And you look for the resumption, or do we have a deeper cut to go? And I think, you know, the jury's still out on that. Humble outlook from the technical standpoint does suggest that risk still remains for a little bit of a pullback in DXY before resumption. But that's where we jump into the deeper time frame charts. So let's jump into the daily. Any questions on the weekly before we move off? Please do a full screen along the way. Hey, Ted, here's the full screen on DXY. Quick reminder, anyone who's new to the room, there is a camera button at the top of your GoTo webinar screen. If you want to take a snapshot of any of the charts you see presented here for reference later in the week, feel free to do so. Here's what DXY looks like on the daily chart. And we will take a moment just to look at yields after this. But first things first, here's the daily chart. And here's our last update on Forex.com published on October 12th, highlighting this pull-off resistance. Now remember, again, that pullback did break that channel. It was a three-point channel, but didn't give us any downside beyond that 236. Again, 105.51, right? We marked a massive outside daily reversal, candle that day as I was publishing this report. And we noted that that in and of itself is a quintessential exhaustion, right? A lot of times when markets are rallying or they're pulling back, the outside reversal candle is sort of that blow off, last bit push before you get some sort of near-term correction. Here's the rebound. Here's what we've done ever since. Last week was a minuscule range. We're just sitting, straddling the objective monthly open, which is 106.17. And it's been kind of lackluster, right? Here's what the intraday chart looked like. Again, earlier in the month, this was on the 10th, right? Here was that downslope. Now, on the webinar on Monday of last week, we talked about the fact that it had broken that downslope, but it was sort of looking for support along that line. And we said, hey, heading into the start of the week, if this breakout is legit, we should find support along that former resistance turn support. Here's what it looks like now. And I wanted to update it with you here on the webinar. So did break, did sit as support. Here's the side-by-side, right? Sat as support. We couldn't even break below 106.17. Again, that's the objective monthly open. We're trying to make that break here. Look, if we break Thursday's low of last week, or basically last week's opening range lows, you're looking for that possible drive again towards 105.50. But until we break that, you know, we're still in the objective monthly range. We can't get too excited. So the threat is for that test of 105.50. And that's where I think we'll get the larger, more defining reaction in price. David, with regards to your question, which we're going to hit in a moment on Euro, something to take into account here, right? Remember, 60% of this, 60 some odd percent of this index is the Euro. So for us to see any type of sustained upward momentum in Euro, it certainly would help. It's not necessitating, but it certainly would help to see DXY start to buckle here at support, give us a little bit more of a pullback as well. Okay, full screen, sir. Here it is, Ted. Let me zoom out for you. It's the same slope we've been following. Okay, this is off the lows from July 23rd. It's the same exact setup. Now, I'm willing to sort of give up this slope at this point, kind of look for a new slope in price. And if we take a pitchfork just off the highs, I haven't looked at this yet. Let me see what this looks like. Too early to rely on that. Basic slope, maybe. Not bad. Again, highlighting in time, the 100% extension at 105. This is a big level, guys, if we buckle 105.50. It's a 50 pip drop to complete two equal legs off the high. And if this is, for those of you who might be acquainted with just relative Elliott wave theory, if this is corrective, meaning the broader trend is still up, many times corrective stances will take the stance of two legs, right? Two equal legs off the high, 100% extension. That would take you into 105. First things first, if we break that objective swing low from last week, 105.50, 105 being key support and a larger area to look for a reaction if we get there. Now, on the flip side of this, what is the level of which, if broken, would sort of shift our focus back to the upside? Guys, that hasn't changed since last Monday, 106.65. The 618 retracement of the decline off the highs from last month, or excuse me, this is the October opening range high. So just the October range. Remember last week we were saying if dollar is heading lower, that would need to hold. You got a little bit of a dribble up here, but it held. And it held again into Thursday, right into the close of the week. That's near-term bearish invalidation. A daily close, a breach above 106.65 would put us back on the resumptive move towards 107 and beyond. Questions on Euro. Can you just quickly show the two equal legs on the chart, please? Zoltan, yeah, absolutely. It's right here, brother. Right here. So let me just draw it for you. Take your Fibonacci extension tool, okay? Go right off the high. واحد, اثنين, ثلاثة, one, two, three. 100% extension is 104.97, right? Basically the 105 handle. Does that make sense? Yeah, you're more than welcome. try not to complicate things, guys. You could basically just draw a line, right? That distance, and then extend it off the next subsequent high, and it'll give you the same formations. Nothing magical. It's just the counting of the tendency of corrective moves to take two equal legs off the high. Does that make sense? Cheers. All right. So that's DXY in a nutshell. Still holding last week's range, so we haven't gotten the break yet. Obviously, the threat is that this break of up channel support yields a larger pullback, bearish below 106.65. Key support at list point is 105.50. That's DXY. A quick reference. I want to look at just a few things. Heading in, so we get more Fed talk later this week with Powell, but we've been getting, you know, everyone's interpreting these comments from Powell in different ways. The hawks are taking this way, and the doves are taking it this way. At the end of the day, markets are pricing in, guys, essentially like a 98% chance that the November interest rate decision will hold where we are, 5.25 to 5.5. Heading into December, you're starting to get a little bit of a lift. There's a 25% some odd chance that we're going to see them hike 25 basis points, but the overwhelming majority is still for a hold. Now, while we're seeing this, the 10-year yield, which has been making all kinds of news, right? I just want to highlight some major things here happening in the 10-year yield. Here's what it looks like on the weekly chart. We highlighted this breakout here in this room on the break above 457. That was huge, right? This was the major breakout. This was, so Zoltan, with regards to your question earlier, this was a measured move off the low. If we were going to see sort of a reversal or an exhaustion failure of the uptrend, that's where we wanted to see the hold. It broke out, tested as support the following week, and pushed to a new high. Now, at this point, starting to get a little tired. Note that momentum is in overbought condition. That's not when you want to necessarily try to fight it, but you're seeing some divergence here. A weak signal, nonetheless. Remember, divergent signals above 70 and below 30 tend to be rather weak signals. But with that in mind, it would suggest that kind of looking for an exhaustion high. Levels we had highlighted were 487. That held for a week. We got the pullback and then we closed above it last week. The next level up is 509, the 1618 extension of the advance. And then the next major sort of pivot is 522 into 529. This is the 2007 high week close and the objective 2007 high. So I still think the threat is for sort of an exhaustive blow off here in the 10-year. And there's a couple of reasons, and I tweeted about this last week. We're seeing a non-confirmation high. So before we move on, here's the 10-year on the daily chart. As it stands, we're poised for an outside daily reversal right here, right now. That's the 4-hour. Not at a daily reversal, excuse me. We're poised for an outside 4-hour reversal bar. I was looking at it right before the webinar started, right? Here's the daily chart again, highlighting continued divergence, right? Remember, when we're looking for divergence, it's only the close that matters. Higher high in price, lower high in the oscillator. Higher high in price, lower high in the oscillator. So you're getting, you know, the red flags are there. This is a parallel of the same exact slope, right? Extended off that swing high from last year, from March of this year. Resistance. You know, we did mark a daily close right above it, but we're basically still there. So I don't know if we get the stretch into five first or not. It's a really big figure, psychological figure that I'm sure traders might want to push towards. But at the end of the day, the exhaustive signals are there. Now, take into account the 2-year yield, which looks like this on the weekly. That never broke resistance. And in fact, this is the same exact chart, believe it or not, guys, go in the archives and look, that we've been looking at essentially since the start of the year, is the 2006 high week close, the 2006 objective swing high, not Mike Boutros's opinion, not Forex.com's opinion, fact, comes in right at 528 into 519. That's exactly where we petered out last week, right? So when you look at these two trades, right? 10-year with a major breakout, multi-year highs, 2-year failing to do that. That non-confirmation high a lot of times is very indicative of near-term market exhaustive tops and bottoms. So we can't put that in the books as a definite or a validated reversal yet, but the threat is there. And when we take that into account with where the dollar is trading at resistance, you can start to see the risk, right? The bulls starting to get a little bit more cautious here. It's been a blind dollar rally for months. That's just not the case from where we are right now, okay? Is this due to weak bond market? So obviously bond prices are inverse, right, Zachary? So as rates go up, yeah, that means bond prices are going down. But you're just not seeing that across the yield curve. You're getting yield reinversion, right? Or you're de-inverting, I should say. Here's the 10-2 spread. You know, this broke below zero, which means the yield curve was inverted since last year. We've never recovered. Here's the rally. We're within 14 basis points of getting the yield curve back above zero. And, you know, a lot of people have referenced this and you'll see it all over Twitter, but actually that's when the highest risk for markets to actually fall into recession, historically speaking. So something to keep in mind. It's when the yield curve comes back from inversion. All right. Good discussion, a little off base. I know we went to the weeds there a little bit, but something to take in mind that just to be watching over the next couple of days and weeks, because this has been very interesting price dynamics here. All right, moving right along. Number two, euro dollar. Here's what euro looks like on the weekly chart. And here was our last update on euro dollar here on forex.com. This was published back on September 29th, so it's almost a month old, but I just wanted to highlight that like the DXY, this weekly chart, you could have just watched this one chart, guys, for this entirety of the month, and you'd still be good. Nothing's changed. The 2023 objective swing low, again, nothing fancy. Fact, 104.82, 104.83 support. Key resistance, objective yearly open resistance. Not Mike Boutros' opinion. Fact, that's 107.04. And just below that, we had that range extending into the objective low week close, right? And that was right there at 106.45, excuse me. Low week close was back here, 106.45. So we've been looking for resistance in this zone, right? And support right here, looking for a breakout of this near-term range for directional guidance. Guys, the entire monthly opening range is defined by this range right here, 104.82, the bottom side of that support zone, 106.45. We're still looking for a breakout of this godforsaken range, right? What else can I say here? Key resistance from the weekly standpoint is still going to be in this range between 107.04. And then up just higher, 107.40s gives you the objective to 52-week moving average. Okay, so you got a 35 pip zone here from the weekly standpoint. That is bearish invalidation, meaning a weekly close above that threshold would suggest a more significant low is in place and would shift the technical focus back to the long side. But while below here, we're still in the bear trend. Right. So this is from 1,000 week up. This is our multi-time frame analysis approach, guys. The weekly chart. What does it look like on the daily? Here's what the daily looks like now. And here was our last update on the daily on Forex.com. By the way, guys, you can find all of these reports on my bio page on Forex.com. Here's the link. And you can also find all of these reports and all these charts on my Twitter handle at MBForex. Also, the archive of this webinar will be published at noon today, 12 noon Eastern time. You'll also find that on my Twitter handle as well. So here's the daily chart. Ted, I see your question for euro real quick. And here was our last update on euro. This was published back on October 10th. Okay. And the focus was, do we get a breach above 106.43? What was 106.43? It was a basic 236 retracement of the decline. And the January low day close. It was an outside reversal day major pivot, okay? Caught the lows back in May, caught the lows back in September before we broke, that was resistance. And we were citing that although the monthly opening range looks like it's breaking to the upside, that's the level we need to be before we start to say, hey, Euro is shifting its technical focus from a trend, near-term trend pattern higher. So we never got it. In fact, this was a great short. We came right into that level, perfect exhaustion, nice reversal candle lower. That failed right ahead of support, which was 104.82. You see how this is working, guys? So now that failed, and here we are probing downtrend resistance. We got two daily closes above. Remember, last week in the webinar, I was telling you guys, look, if it's going to break 105.84, that's the level we'd look for the sort of resumptive move higher. We broke above it on Friday, but it's not giving us the accelerated push I'd want to see. David, your question early in the webinar was, in your humble opinion, has euro dollar turned upward from its long weekly downtrend when looking at the daily and 4 hour charts? Do we need a vertical parallel line trending up? So this is what we were looking at again earlier in the month, right? This was back on what, October 10th. So a couple of weeks ago, this was the near-term uptrend we were looking for. Here's what it looks like now. It's the same exact setup. It's the same exact setup. Nothing's changed. The only thing that's changed is this gradient dipped down a little bit with that last spill we made on the 13th. So I had that connecting these two. We're now connecting these two. But at the end of the day, here's that downslope. If this breakout is legit, losses should be limited to 105.30. Resistance targets unchanged. 106.43 is still the objective monthly opening range high. That 236, the January low day close. This is still the breakout to validate sort of a larger run in euro. Okay. Guys, I'm getting someone saying you lost the connection. Can I just get a quick heads up? Give me a quick yes if you can still hear my voice and see the screen. Might be an isolated issue. Okay, Todd, thanks. And thanks. It's probably just an isolated issue there. Scott, cheers. David, appreciate it. Cheers, cheers. So that's where I'm at on the euro, guys. If this breakout of channel resistance is legit, losses should be limited by 105.35. You need to close above 106.43 to validate resumption higher for this near-term uptrend. In that scenario, the yearly open is still big whopper resistance. The yearly open is that 52-week moving average, okay? That's up here. That's up here. So look, for euro, DXY, and sterling's even worse. We'll hit sterling too. That thing is just holding a well-defined range. But for all of these, we've been in this back and forth for the last week and a half. We did drive into a major turn on all of those trades since the start of the month, but ever since, it's kind of been a hangover effect. So tread lightly, use caution, be meticulous. Like I said, it's the last full week of October, a break close above 106.43 to validate that a more important low is registered here, or break below 105.40 to mark resumption of the broader downtrend. In that case, you're looking for 104. Questions on euro dollar. The ECB is on tap on Thursday. They're expected to hold rates at 4.5%. Obviously, the commentary is going to be really what drives markets. So keep that on mind on tap Thursday morning for euro dollar. Right into the close of the week, I didn't mention it earlier, but we do have those key inflation data out of the US. So for both DXY and euro, Thursday, Friday ends up being sort of the action zone, right? You have the ECB on Thursday, and then on Friday, you get not only the CPI, personal consumption expenditure, PCE, the Fed's preferred inflationary gauge, but you get core PCE. So we're expecting core to fall 3.7 from 3.9%, and headlines expectedly to downtick to 3.4. Any questions on euro or DXY or yields? Okay. That's number one and two, sterling. Here's British pound. So I put out an update on this last week, and really, like, we're just still on tap. We're waiting for this breakout. Here's what the weekly chart looked like last week. And the basic focus here, just like Euro, just like DXY, is this larger zone range rather on the weekly chart. For the euro, for the sterling, it's really well defined. Yearly open support, that's 120.84. The objective low week close of the year, 121.13, that's key support. It's been key support for 4 weeks. You can literally rinse, wash, repeat, and just watch the webinar for the last 4 weeks. We've been saying the same exact thing. We need a clearing of this zone, guys. You need to close below the yearly open to validate resumption of this downtrend. You need to breach above that January high week close, that 52-week moving average, the 618 retracement of the yearly range. It's all loaded right here. That's the breakout. So it's really well-defined levels, but again, momentum flatlining. And that can be frustrating, guys. And really, if you're looking for exciting trades, the latter part of the webinar is where it's at, because oil, gold, massive moves, even stocks, beautiful news. In FX, it's been rather isolated. We're still waiting for some directional clarity. And when that happens, guys, you know, you can't have FOMO in this game. We have to wait. We have to remain disciplined. My book has been super light for the last week just because we're waiting for some of these zones to clear. Patience pays, okay? That's sterling on the weekly chart. Sterling on the daily chart looks a little bit different. The daily chart really highlights a very well-defined weekly opening range. This was, monthly opening range. This was highlighted back on October 11th. And the focus there was stop traffic. We're checking resistance. Massive region. We just talked about it. 2315, bottom end of that zone, real near term was 22, basically the 23 handle, right? Big zone, downtrend, resistance. We highlighted resistance there, support at the yearly open. Again, that 786 retracement. We're looking for a breakout of the objective monthly opening range while highlighting that a downside close below 2084 would be really bad, really bad. I mean, this thing skirted disaster here. Also is really strong divergence. So let me take that back. Not strong divergence, but divergence nonetheless in momentum. So nice bounce, nice reversal off downtrend resistance. What the hell is this now? We're just sitting at support, okay? Now, if we drill down real deep, guys, I just wanna highlight some interesting stuff. Here's the outside reversal candle we made off the low for the month, right? So we took out the previous day's lows, took out the previous day's highs and closed above that. That outside day reversal candle close comes in at 21.35. Look at this on a close basis ever since. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. So again, the levels are well-defined. Monthly open resistance at this point is 122, 121.99. That's what these dots are. Initial support, 120, 130, 121.35, that's support. But ultimately, we're still looking for a breakout of the monthly opening range. So listen, you have a range within a range, okay? And we're looking for guidance there. I know that might not help a lot of you, but that's just the fact of where we are in price. Drill down even deeper. Here's what it looks like on the four-hour chart, side-by-side comparison, again, of what it looked like last week. Not much has changed. I take that back. This is not last week. This is from October 10th, right? Yeah, 11th. So this has changed. That upslope, we've got rid of it because when we broke here, let me show you how that looked. When we broke channel support, when we broke pitchfork support, you didn't get any run. Here's what we were looking at, right? And this is why we were looking for resistance here, because you had that 75% parallel there. Looks really, really good. Get that exact, okay? Looks really good. So it was a great trade. Perfect failure, pull back into uptrend support. This is where you cut the line. We're flat now. We're looking for the possibility of resumption. Well, we didn't get it. But then the break was really messy. And this is for me when I just take a step back. All right, this pitchfork has used its usefulness. It's no longer bearing fruit as support or resistance. Drop that. Let's stick to basics. Here's the basics, right? Channel resistance is right above that 122 handle. That is also the objective monthly open. Again, the monthly opening range is preserved. Now, if we're looking at the DXY, which we just looked at, right? It's the same setup. It's the same setup. If DXY does give us that decent pullback and the risk for that larger corrective move lower, that might be the break here that takes Sterling higher through downtrend resistance. Even if that happens, guys, this is still major resistance, a major lateral pivot that they would need to rally through to mark resumption, or to mark reversal, rather. Does that make sense? Do we have a potential bottom on sterling dollar on the daily chart, a double bottom? So good question, Febby, and it's oftentimes, I don't mean to pick on you, like 99% of the times people cite that, it's just way too early, okay? If you're talking about this being a double bottom on the daily chart, I'm assuming you're talking about these bottoms, it's the break of, you know, that high that gives us the measured move, guys. Otherwise, any test of support or resistance could potentially be a double bottom. That's right. But that doesn't even filter into my thought process, Febby, until we break the highs, or if it was a double top, until we break the lows. So just something to keep in mind. It could very well be. It's 23. The breach above 23 would be when that's actionable. But until that happens, it's just a test of support right now. Does that make sense? Okay, Mike, noted. Cheers. Right on. Ted, you say, please adjust the pitchfork. Which pitchfork are you talking about? If you want to give me some more info on that. So that's Sterling in a nutshell. Nothing really more to add there. You have employment data on tap tomorrow, so keep that in mind. We are expecting actually a contraction of 198,000 jobs for the month of July. The unemployment rate is expected to hold 4.3 though, so that hits tomorrow. Brandon, are we reviewing gold and the indices? 100%. Brandon, that's where all the action is, in my humble opinion. FX has been really slow. Okay, so let's get through this. That's Sterling. Next is, that's number four. Number five is Dollar Cat. Here's what Looney looks like first on the weekly chart and back on the intraday. So our last update on the Canadian dollar was back on Friday. And actually, this is the weekly chart. I just wanted to give you guys a highlight of a big, big level. And I was writing this midday about noon on Friday, talking about the weekly close and whether we close above 37. So we actually did close above 37. But momentum is not giving you any run here. And this is, again, if the dollar is going to get a pullback, I don't want to be caught on the other side of this trade holding long, especially if this is a failure at confluence resistance. Guys, we've been talking about 137 for 4 weeks. It's the 786 retracement of this year's range. It's downtrend resistance for this pitchfork we've been following back from 2017. And again, the 20 highs. Caught the highs last year, caught the highs back in March. That's resistance. So what do we do with this? What do we do with this? If this was a legit break, I would have wanted to see some upside acceleration here. This is a big, big multi-year slope resistance. So indecision, jump down into the daily chart, see if we can get any clarity there. Well, the daily chart says stop traffic. You're still within the objective monthly opening range. Here's your monthly open. You rally for the first 3 days of the month. And guess what? We're still holding that 3 day rally range. So it's either a close above 37.75, which is the 88.6 retracement. Again, this was the update back on October 6th, right? Same exact levels. We broke that September high day close and corrected lower, but we didn't even test bullish inval. This was the level that we had highlighted as bullish invalidation, with first support being that monthly open at 35.70. That's what held the monthly open at 35.77. Back into the September high day close, we pivoted above that. Now support, key resistance unchanged, 37.61 into 37.74. So look, drive down even deeper in price. Here's what the intraday chart looks like now. Here's what it looked like back earlier in the month, right? Here's the side-by-side. We dropped down, held the monthly open, popped back up, still holding resistance. So if this near-term bounce, and I'm getting really granular in price, and I don't publish these kind of analysis because it'll just confuse the hell out of everyone. But if we do really near-term price action, I wanted to show you this. Since Zoltan was asking about the 100%, was that Zoltan? About the extensions or two equal legs. Here's two equal legs off the low. So an Elliott wave, five wave are motive patterns. One, two, three being the largest, four, five waves up means the broader trend is still rated to the upside, right? Corrective, this looks like possible five waves down, but here's one, two, three. So if we're starting to get three wave patterns up, it would suggest this is corrective and the threat is for a pullback. Now, it just so happens that 3737 literally has been rock solid resistance for the last 3 days. So that also happens to coincide on uptrend resistance as well. So in my humble opinion, the threat here may be lower below 3775, 3760 near term, but that's just within the confines of the monthly opening range. At the end of the day, that's the breach that you need to validate resumption of the uptrend. That's the break you need to validate reversal and a larger correction lower. Does that make sense? The two equal legs up suggest that that move is corrective, which means the broader risk right now may actually be to the downside. I hope I'm not losing anyone. Guys, let me know if that makes sense. Two legs. Yeah, Zoltan, that was. I got you. All right. Yep. All right. Makes sense. Right on. Right on. Okay, cool. So that's where I'm at with dollar CAD. Just as a disclaimer, I'm flat here. I don't have any positioning on it. But looking at this really closely over the next couple of days, you really don't have any major data on tap until the Bank of Canada on Wednesday morning. They're expected to hold at 5%. So we'll see how that pans out. But in combination with the price action we're seeing in the dollar index, really the initial focus for me right now is basically what kind of, if we get another exhaustion high or if we buckle back below 36.85 near-term support. Okay. All right. Last of the FX crosses. Oh, we got two more to go. Wow, we're falling behind. So let me go really quick here. Here's dollar CAD. Dollar yen. Nothing really to say here, guys. Literally at all. I wrote a piece on this last week. Here is the update. Again, you can find all of this on my Twitter handle, my bio page on Wednesday. I just wanted to highlight the objective nature of where we are in trade. The title really says it all, guys. It's poised for a breakout, but we haven't gotten that breakout yet. Recall 47.68, 148.70, big zone. We were talking about that zone for months. We buckled above it. That was support all through the course of this month. That's still support. But if you drill down even deeper, the monthly opening range is preserved, and even last week's weekly opening range was preserved. Okay, here's the daily chart. Remember, on a trade like this, the entire month opening range is defined by this October 3rd candle. Ever since that October 3rd outside reversal candle off the high, my entire game plan has been look for a breakout of this candle's range, literally, for guidance. We haven't been able to break the highs. We haven't even come close to the lows. So this month, this whole month opening range is defined by that one candle, and we're looking for the breakout. Very simple. Close above the 2022 close high, which was 150.14. You're looking for a substantiated, almost 200 pip rally to the upside to the 2022 highs, objective levels. If we break and buckle back below 47.68, the low comes a little bit lower, but I'm willing to work with 47.68, which was last year's high day close. If we break below that, well, then you're looking for a larger correction within the uptrend. I know there's a lot of slope here, guys. I don't want to get too into the weeds here, but the basic focus for dollar yen, the only thing we need to be looking for, honestly, is that break of this single candle to get some guidance here. Drill down even deeper. Here was last week's range. It's insane, right? So until we get a breakout, and here's another one where, remember, we were following that ascending pitchfork really clean for quite some time. When the break happened, we were like, man, we didn't get much run to the downside. So let's look for resistance at former slope support. Well, we got it. kicked off, but even that downside was quickly thwarted. Looking at price action here again, it looks like someone's trying to hold a balloon underwater. Looks like this thing wants to pop up, right? Despite that feeling and the way that the market looks, guys, and whatever you've been thinking, we have to remain disciplined. 5414 is still my line in the sand. If the dollar is going to correct lower, if yields do take a little bit of a breather, I don't want to be buying dollar yen at the highs. That's crazy. But if we get a substantiated close, breakout, weekly close above 15014, all bets are off. Right. I guess at that point, you should say all bets are on. Questions on dollar yen? All right. Last but not least from the FX pairs, before we jump into the really juicy stuff, is Aussie. Very similar. Again, nothing's changed here as well. Aussie's been holding on the weekly chart into this critical region for quite some time. This was published back on October 13th, and the basic focus of this trade was we broke 6380. This is problematic, okay? You're now looking for channel or basic slope support. Remember, this is a four-point touch slope. Any 2 points can make a trend line. It's the third that confirms it. So we got a fourth here. And then the major lateral level down at 62. That's absolutely huge. It's 100% extension off the high. It's last year's low close. It's the 2008 low close. So really well-defined levels here. Last week we rallied. Where did the rally fail? Right at 63.80, right on the dot, guys. Puts us right into focus still for a breakout of this near-term range. Ted, here's the full screen picture. Okay. Looking at this from a momentum standpoint, it's not divergence, but certainly it's not like super gung-ho for the bears right now. So just putting that out there. Here's what it looks like on the daily chart. Okay. Again, a trade where the monthly opening range is defined by just this two-day stretch. We've never broken out of that range. Would necessitate a break above 64.30 to really validate a larger reversal and a rebound off downtrend support. The lateral level support is rock solid, unchanged, 62.80 into 62.98. The October low day close from last year, the 88.6 retracement from last year's rally, holding support like no one's business, like no one's business. So well-defined levels, looking for some Momo here to get this thing cracked. Till we do, sit tight. Here's what it looks like on the intraday chart. Just wanted to highlight this near-term consolidation pattern. It's not the cleanest, but certainly near term when you're looking at a trade that's contracting within the monthly opening range, these tend to work out pretty well. You got a series of very minor higher lows and definitely lower highs. So possibly a formation breakout here that could give us an indication of the next move. But till we do, this thing is just coiling, 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 coiling. Not much Aussie data this week. So look for broader dollar price action to really continue driving things here. Questions? All right, that is Aussie. Okay, let's jump into the commodities. We got about 18 minutes here. Let's get through the commodities and stocks. So gold first. Woo-wee! You guys, I hope you can hear the smile on my face. Not going to spend any time on gloating because we don't have any time for that. But here's what gold looks like, guys. The reversal was very significant. Don't quote me on this, but I think the last 2 weeks was the one of the largest two-week span rallies that we've seen in gold's history. It might be the second. I can't remember. Someone quoted it to me. But just going back to October 10th, coming into the start of the month, saying on the weekly charts, we're looking for support. We're looking for a low, right? And the levels that we were looking for, initially we were looking for low at 1871. Don't forget, I was definitely 100% dead wrong on that. That thing broke and it didn't even give us a blip on the radar. We just rocketed right through it. The second two levels we were talking about was the yearly open and this cluster down here of major fib levels, 100% off the high, 618 off the low, August swing highs from last year, swing lows from this year, loaded. Guys, that ended up being the low. We didn't get another strike at it, yearly open support held. Then we highlighted 1891 as bearish invalidation. meaning a weekly close above 1891 invalidates the bear trend and would suggest a more important low is registered and would shift the focus back to the long side. In such a scenario, your first level of significance is 1988, last year's high week close. Key resistance up here in this week's high week close, in this year's rather high week close. So here's the trade, guys. I just want to show you that even the weekly charts can be very fruitful if we're disciplined in how we read them. So here was the rebound. Remember, 1891 was our bearish inval. We plowed through it and closed well above channel resistance and that 1891 level, well above the 52-week yearly moving average. Keeps the focus on a strike of 1988 and then 2016. There was a retracement there that's since been removed, but let me just bring you the lateral level. 2016 would be the high we closed for this year. So no change to those levels, guys. No change to those levels. We rallied into resistance. I put that out on Friday, telling you guys to watch the close, and we closed below it. That level was 1988. Here's what it looks like on the daily chart. And here was our last update on the gold short term published on Tuesday of last week, right? As we had defined the breakout, we were already above that longer term bearish invalidation level. So we were looking higher. 1945, 1977 to 1987 was the level of resistance that we highlighted. Sort of a key rock to keep an eye on. Here was the rally. Here was Friday's failure. What does that mean now? Brandon says, is subscription service in the works or is this only week? Stay tuned, Brandon. Stay tuned. I'll keep you guys updated on Twitter on anything there. There's a lot in the works, so I'll keep you guys updated. But back to business. What does this mean right now? Well, guys, it means that the immediate drive may be vulnerable below this zone. Remember, it's not only the key 618 retracement of the decline off the yearly high. It's not only just the objective July swing high, it's also former support, break, resistance. I think we got our answer on Friday. Now, that's not to say that we're bearish, but that's to say that the immediate advance may be vulnerable sub 1987. Okay, if we were to get a daily close above that, you still have to contend with that March 14th reversal close. I know it's a random date, guys, but to me, this holds significance. It wasn't even an outside reversal candle, but the close, this was a new high, right, for the year. The close of that candle was just rock solid pivot. Again, don't take my word for anything. Look at price. This was the highs for the previous month. And then when we broke through it as resistance, which held for weeks, it was support. And then again, the break yielded acceleration. Even when the markets break these levels, guys, this is what I want to see. It's an area of low tolerance. The market doesn't want to sit here. It either rejects it or when it breaks, it runs through. Rejects it or when it breaks, it runs through. So for me, that's 2004. That's the next level on the upside you need to close above to get really another extended rally. But right now, that's my concern for gold, is this key region of resistance that we've been watching for weeks now. Okay, here's what the near-term chart looked like. It's still pretty darn clean too. I hate these really acute ascending channels, guys. The more sharper the ascent, the less efficacy I've seen that they'll have. But man, this one remains rather clear. Here's what it looks like now. Okay, side-by-side comparison, no change. Here, Ted, here's the full screen, brother. And here's the side-by-side comparison. So we opened on Monday. Remember on the webinar, we said as long as 1903 holds support, we're constructive essentially. But we need to see support 1903 not even challenged. And guys, it didn't even get challenged. 1914, the top end, that was the low. Before breaking higher, 1945, break, test of support, right into the highs. right into the highs. Now, I just wanted to do a quick update on this chart for you to show you how we walk through this trade setup. So on Friday, I was talking to you, I tweeted this exact chart and said, watch the close. We couldn't even get a 4-hour close above that 1977, 1987 level before pushing lower. So where do we look at now? Well, now I take a quick retracement, real near term, of this advance. Okay, the 236 highlights channel support. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and drop that 50 at this point. Don't need that anymore. I'm gonna go ahead and drop that 38.2 at 1914. Don't need that anymore. Get rid of that shaded region. Key support near term, 1953. A break below that would really risk, not my favorite scenario, guys, but would really risk a drop to 1903. Okay, that would be former channels resistance support. That would be that 38.2 retracement. This is the longer data retracement of the advance off last year's low. It's been a major pivot, right? And that would be a test of former, you know, that former slope just has support before bouncing off. That's all contingent on 1953 holding this week. So in a nutshell, gold, if this uptrend is to maintain, to remain viable, losses need to be limited by 1953. A close above 1987 is needed to mark resumption. Next major level on the upside, 2004. Okay. Questions on gold? Okay, should we jump into stocks? Oil, real quick. Yeah. I can't forget about oil. No. This is big. So here's just a couple of things. This was the webinar last week. I just wanted to bring this up because I did put a chart out here for you on oil. And while this was a very messy chart, look how it played out. 88 for me was the line in the sand. If this is corrective, again, today is all about the two equal legs, a great lesson for any of you who've been wondering. Two equal legs, if this was corrective, 88 should have held. And that's what I said to you guys on Monday, right? If we're heading lower, which again, you guys know, longer term, I've been bullish oil, that hasn't changed. We're trying to gauge whether the correction off the high is done or whether there's a deeper pullback before resumption. And for me, that level was 88. So once that broke, great, 89, 84. Then we got exhaustion and a pullback to close the week right back at that 100% extension. And now here we are since the start of the week with that as resistance. Was this a false break type of play? I don't know. Let me take you back. Guys, here's the weekly chart. I'm going backwards on this, but here's the weekly chart. Okay. Key support at 83.02, 83.28, like a charm. Right, like a charm. Here's the high week close for the year. That's 90.79. That was exact resistance last week. That's not what I wanted to see. If this pullback was the extent of it and we were looking for a resumption, I wouldn't have wanted to see rejection to that magnitude at the high week close. So looking at this from a weekly standpoint, in my mind, it's a little scary for the threat of a completion for an actual correction, which again, three waves or even just a three-wave pattern, forget two equal legs, would have to be another stretch lower. So I still think the threat is there for some further weakness, but if the dollar pulls back, that's a tailwind. And again, I don't want to take, you know, I'm not really interested in getting on the short side of this. I've been constructive and I'm looking largely for pullbacks to offer better buying opportunities. But for me, unfortunately, that's not until we get a pullback down to here or a concerted buckle and close above 91.78, the high day close for the year. And then you'll be looking for resumption, right? The uptrend levels, guys, are vast, getting towards 100. There's a lot of room. The question is, is this correction done? Is that the extent of it? Or do we have one more low to make before the resumptive move? Again, it's either a breach above 91.78 to mark that resumption or a break below 83, in which case you're looking for a test of the early open. How is oil correlated to the dollar? Zach, that correlation is not really strong right now. There are times where the correlation is strong and not, obviously, you know, oil being priced in dollars. But really, I mean, I wouldn't be to answer your question. I wouldn't even be looking at that right now. Because here's oil rallying and here's the dollar rallying. So that correlation is not very strong right now. Typically they're inverse, right? When the dollar is really strong, the dollar oil is priced in dollars, you don't need as many dollars to buy it, right? But that's just not a correlation or a relationship I would put into consideration in my trading at this point, not in this environment. It's important to know, guys, when to really look at those correlations and consider them, and when just to leave them on the back burner. It's just noise right now at that point. So that's gold and oil. Any questions? No change to any of those levels on that last setup from last week. Okay, that's everything from the reports. Let's jump into, oops, I messed up. I did want to show you one thing. Okay. In any event, it was on the last week's update, guys. I don't have the link right in front of me. So let me just jump into the SPX 500. This thing has been insane. Really clean. So here's the weekly chart from 1,000 feet up. Go ahead and snap your photos, guys, from the helicopter view. Can it get cleaner than this? Can it get cleaner than this? A break of uptrend support mid-December was the onslaught of this decline. Levels that we highlighted, 43, 47, didn't offer any resistance, didn't offer any support, but after we broke below it, it was resistance for the last 2 weeks. The first major level that we were talking about that we missed on that initial October sell-off is now upon us. Guys, it starts as low as that 52-week moving average. So it's 41.78 into 41.96. Write it down. Put a post now, label your charts, absolutely critical over the next week, right now, today. What is that level? It's the 38.2 retracement from the advance off last year's low. All right, cool, whatever. It's the February range highs, meaning it's the yearly opening range high for the S&P 500, which held all the way through May. It's also the objective 52-week yearly moving average. Not Michael Boutros's opinion, not Forex.com's opinion, fact. This is a massively significant technical level. It's pretty clear cut. The immediate decline vulnerable into this level. With that same respect, guys, a close below this level is terminal, essentially, for the uptrend off last year's low. So we're heading to make or break levels. Here's what the S&P 500 looks like on the daily chart. That's from the weekly chart we derived all that, right? Now look at the daily chart. Here's the monthly open. You slam lower. You try to test monthly open resistance, plow through. I was looking, if you guys recall, here's what the intraday chart looked like last week. I was looking for exhaustion to 44.16 or 44.56. That was the game plan last week. Look for topside exhaustion off one of these two levels. Here's how it planned out. And I wanted to show you guys how we refine our bias with price action. So here was last week's webinar. We pushed higher. Remember, we opened the webinar turning right ahead of that 100% extension. We were even saying the threat is still for kind of a rebound higher, the turn and an exhaustion off one of these two levels. Here's an outside reversal candle on the 4-hour chart that went for a test of fresh weekly highs and then faltered. When you get a candle like these, guys, they're very actionable because oftentimes the breakout of this single candle range will be the defining conviction tool that you need. Meaning, as soon as we got an outside reversal higher, I'm looking for a breakout of this range. We pulled back, I'm doing nothing. Uh-oh, it broke. And you got a candle close below it. You're looking for the drive into 43. You got it. Bounce higher, that broke. This was bullish invalidation, 42.79. and any shorts that you had would have been cleaned up essentially here. Probably your limits would have been right here. That broke, held resistance. You're now looking for 42.59 below day close. You're looking for 41.83. And that's the huge level we just talked about on the weekly charts. Okay, this is massive. So yes, the risk is for a little bit lower. That decline at risk into 41.83, I want to see a stronger reaction there in price this week if reached. Any questions on the S&P 500? Now, I'm over on time, guys, so I have to run real quick, but you're seeing, first of all, a couple of notes. The VIX is on the climb, okay? This is the daily chart of the VIX. It's getting to decent levels, of which we want to see some sort of an uptick in volatility. Here's what it looks like on the weekly chart. I don't really track this super close, guys, but when the VIX is starting to move higher, that just fuels the expectation that what we're seeing in price action actually may, there's conviction behind it. So just a note on that. Okay. NASDAQ, here's what the NASDAQ looks like from 1,000 feet up, weekly chart, okay? We just broke uptrend support to the downside. The first major level here is 14,244 into 14,350. 618 retracement, this is the entire decline off the 2021 high. That 618 has been a decent pivot in price. I'm still looking at that. And then two equal legs off the high, the theme of the webinar, 1, 2, 3, boom. Even if this is corrective, there's still room for 14,244, 14,350. That's key support. From a weekly chart, from 1,000 feet up, it also converges on uptrend slope this week, okay? Drill down deeper. Here's NDX on the daily chart. A little bit cleaner. It looked like the pivot break below this channel line was kind of invalidated when we broke behind it. But again, an outside reversal candle off of resistance. Guys, these have been so fruitful over the last couple of weeks. That was the quintessential. That was basically the tell that, you know, we're still heading lower. So we looked for a pivot below 14,969, which was just that gap that we filled. Once we pivoted below, here's the monthly open. Guys, we're now challenging a break of the monthly opening range lows. Not my opinion, fact. That's 14,575. If we close below this today, objectively, that's a bearish signal looking for a drive into 14,281, 14,254. Not a trade recommendation, guys, from Forex.com or StoneX. Just this is what the technicals are suggesting at this point if this level breaks. Does that make sense? So drill down even deeper on the NASDAQ. Looks like you have a really modified pitchfork formation. It's actually been working pretty well. I just highlighted this on Friday because I was saying, you know, my line in the sand was going to be the monthly open because near-term uptrend support, you can null and void that at this point. But the median line for this descending formation was there as well. Guys, here's the break. If we maintain a stance below 14,723, you know, the threat is still for that drive into that major lateral support zone. All right, last but not least, the Dow Jones looks like this. First on the weekly chart, not the cleanest of the lot, but certainly threatening a major break right here. Last week on the Dow, we marked an outside weekly reversal, took out the previous week's highs, stopped right on resistance, turned and closed well below the previous week's low. This gap here, okay, anything sub 3,300 is very problematic. Is very problematic. Guys, this is the closed lows from May. Don't take my word for it. There it is. This is my favorite Fibonacci confluences, a 618 retracement of the entire yearly range, two equal legs off the high. Gives you a key support zone. If we close below this, sayonara, big threat. So the Dow for me is the one that's flashing red the most. Bearish and validation, in my humble opinion, would be right at the yearly moving average. I don't typically put so much emphasis on it, but this thing has been ridiculous, guys. This yearly moving average, specifically on the Dow, is just like a pivot, straight up. Support, break, now resistance. Breach, now support. Break, acceleration on both sides. Break, instant resistance. For me, at least on the near term or the medium term, that's my bearish invalidation level on the Dow. Drill down to the Dow on the first on the daily chart, just highlighting the uncovered gap. It's not uncovered anymore. So actually, let me drop that. You don't need that anymore. But the January objective swing low has been a level that I'm watching, and it converges on this median line for this downtrend over the next few days. But based on what we were looking at on that daily, on that weekly chart, man, the threat is for some serious weakness here if we close a weekly close below this level. All right. Okay. Well over on time, as always. It's a great time starting the week off with you guys. Best of luck trading this week. Keep in mind the ECB on Thursday, the BOC first on Wednesday, ECB on Thursday, and then some of that core PCE key inflation data out of the US into the close of the week. Obviously, keep your eyes out on the unfolding situation with the geopolitics, guys. That's not something we can trade around, but it's something we do need to be aware of. Best of luck trading, Zoltan and Zachary. Ted, thanks for all your love and all the appreciation. I will check you guys next week, same time, same channel. Best of luck trading. Cheers.